Hello everyone, I am Srinivasan Narayan. I am the founder and CEO of the Cohort Plus platform. First of all, thank you everyone who's joined this session. I think it's very heartening to see people come in on a lazy Saturday and start hearing about product management careers. I understand all of us are have our commitments over the weekend, and it's really heartening to see people come in. So thanks one and all. And I also wanted to take this opportunity to let you know about Cohort Plus as a platform. We are one of the largest, in fact, the largest community for product managers in India, and one of the largest globally. And we started out in somewhere around December 2017, and since then we've grown leaps and bounds in terms of the number of subscribed users we have on the platform, and also the number of posts, comments, etc. that gets created every day on the platform. So this is the most engaging product management community you can get globally. A little bit about our journey. So after we started in 16 December, in fact, we grew pretty well in the product management domain. We have close to, I think, 20,000 product managers, as well as product aspirants, product enthusiasts who are live on the platform, on our Cohort Plus platform. And somewhere around a couple of months back, a lot of you would be aware, we actually got bought by a higher education company called Upgrad, which is run by filmmaker Anish Poovala, Mayank Kumar, Ravi Jyot and Falgun, the four founders of the company. And we've joined hands with Upgrad. Upgrad is a higher education company, and now we become part of Upgrad. And both of us actually have the common objective of becoming career partners for a lot of people who are looking to upskill themselves in new age careers, and one such domain is product management. Cohort Plus has always been a career partner to users, but now with the association, with the strong association of Upgrad, and with Upgrad backing us, we sincerely hope that we can actually help you even more in fashioning your careers. This event specifically is also an event in that direction itself, towards helping users fashion their careers. So here today we will be discussing about product management as a discipline, how it has evolved in India, how you can actually make a switch to product management from an unrelated domain, from a business domain, from a non-tech domain, because a lot of people feel that product managers are ex-software engineers, but that's just a small portion of product managers here in India. And also, how do you crack product management interviews? What product management, what lays in store for product management in India? And to actually discuss all this, I have with me my close friend and a product management expert himself, Girish. Welcome, Girish.
Thank you, Srini.
So Girish has extensive product management experience. He's built products both for India as well as for global companies. He's also, run his own startup for some time. Girish is currently a senior product manager at Intuit, and he works, closely on their flagship product, TurboTax. Prior to Intuit, he's actually worked for ZipDial, a voice-based startup out of India, which got acquired by Twitter, one of the early, India success stories. And Girish was instrumental in scripting that acquisition. Post that, Girish worked for the e-commerce company Zivame, so he also has good e-commerce experience. After that, he did his startup for a short time in the mobility domain, and then he actually joined Intuit. So he has extensive experience in both the P2C domain as well as the P2B domain, and both he has experience in not just building products for India, but also being here, working with the team, and building products that are accepted globally. TurboTax being a great example. So I have been chasing Girish for some time, and thankfully, all the stars fell in place, and I have him here today. So the way this would work is we have some good questions that have come in already. So we will try to prioritize it and ask those questions and credit the users who have actually asked those questions. And apart from that, we will also, you know, start taking questions live. So any other question that you have in your mind, don't hesitate. Just start posting those questions here in the chat section. I'll keep reading those questions and throwing them at Girish. And Girish, from his vast experience, he will dig into his trenches and give us all the right answers. This video will get recorded and we will share the recorded link with you. So you don't really have to worry about that piece. All the information that is getting exchanged here is something that is there for the records, and that is something that will get shared with you. So that's how the whole thing will play out. Welcome Girish again, and let's begin. So Girish, the first question that I would like to ask you is, and this is a very common question, and I will also kind of keep it a little generic. A lot of people in the product management community on Cohort Plus and at large in India want to enter the product management domain. But one, they have a notion that they are not from a software engineering background. Two, even if they are from a software engineering background, they really don't know how to make that transition. You yourself have made your transition. You were a design engineer at NVIDIA earlier. So I would like to understand, how can these people who are looking for a transition, how can they take the next step in their careers and enter the product management domain in India? And let's split this into two parts. First, let us talk about people who are not in the software engineering domain and so-called unrelated domain. How can they actually, make their foray into product management in India?
So, first of all, thank you for having me here. Proud to be associated with Cohort Plus. One thing I should call out is, Srini has done a great job, not just providing a platform to help people grow their careers, but also nurture it, nudge people. Cohort Plus over the years has done a great job, and congratulations on the successful acquisition to Upgrad.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, coming to the question, yes, this is one of probably the most common questions that you come across from a product management perspective. A lot of people have the notion that you need a technical background in order to be a product manager. So just coming to the two aspects of it, you mentioned how do we transition to product management, and do you need the technical expertise in order to be a good product manager, right? So I'll just start with, what does it take to be a product manager? You need passion, you need a good intellect, you need to be the voice of the customer, you need customer empathy, customer focus. But at the end of the day, what you really need is a lot of energy. Nowhere in this list of must-haves for a product manager is the technical know-how coming. A lot of the great successful product managers I know are not technical people. I can give an example of my own director at Intuit. He's not even completed his schooling, but he is a great product manager, right? So it's just the passion that he had that led him down the path of, building products, and eventually today he's driving a large product team at Intuit. In no way is this an outlier, right? There are a lot of people who are very successful product managers who are not from a, these standard traditional engineering backgrounds, but who have been very successful at product management. So just continuing on that, you don't have to be from the technical field, you don't have to be an engineer. I'll come back to where it helps if you have the technical expertise, if you have the engineering background, how it helps and where it helps. But that's not a prerequisite in order to be a good product manager.
Got it.
Now coming to the second part of the question, if you're in the software domain, and if you would like to transition to becoming a product manager, how do you go about doing so?
I think before that, if you're not from a software engineering domain, sure, right, and you want to enter product management,
okay,
I mean, is that some kind of a, I would say, copybook procedure or some ways in which, you know, people who are not from a software engineering domain can transition? Maybe we can, you know, spend a few minutes on that, and then we'll actually go to the people who are in the software engineering domain.
Sure, sounds good. So if you're not in the software engineering domain per se, right? So if you know, as a company, it's looking to hire product managers, what would the company you know, look for? Let's start with that, right? Let's look at what does a company look for when it's trying to hire a product manager.
And backtrack and kind of, you know,
see how you can, yeah, how you can fit in
that domain. Yes.
Exactly. So companies would love to know if you have an empathy towards products, if you have an empathy towards customers, building products that customers love.
Sure.
And here, we are not taking customers in the literal sense. It could be a B2B offering, it could be a B2C offering, basically the end users of the product.
Got it.
Have you already demonstrated that in some way?
Got it.
Right? It could just be that, you know, you're great at building prototypes.
Sure.
That's a skill that is needed. You're great at you know, evangelizing and communicating the benefits of a product, right? That's another great skill to have. You're great at, you know, design,
sure,
right? You're great at, you can do the best mock-ups that are there. None of these needed, you know, strong
technical
engineering
expertise,
technical expertise, right?
Sure.
How can you demonstrate these, right? Can you actually bring this out? Can you actually put this out in the way that the companies who are looking to hire a product manager understand that, hey, okay, here is a person who's demonstrating this skill, and this is how this will fit into my product roadmap, right? If you can, and here the trick is not to let the company bridge that gap. Trick is how you can actually bridge that gap for the company and show that your skills are actually aiding the company in, you know, building out its product vision.
Got it. Makes sense. So in summary, Girish, then what you're trying to say is the product manager need not really be hugely technically inclined. He or she fundamentally needs to be, you know, the voice of the customer, the most extensive user of the product, and understand customer needs.
Yep.
And for a non-technical PM, for a non-technical guy who's trying to become a PM, he or she has to demonstrate the ability, this ability of being the voice of the customer, and that could be, you know, either through his or her design skills, it could be through his or her articulation skills, which helps, you know, him or her sell the product to the end user, or it could generally be through his or her, you know, skills, analytical and analytical skills and skills around insights, which helps unearth some really good gems around the needs of the customer. Got it.
Yeah, well put. I couldn't agree more on that. Definitely on that. Now if you look at how a person already in the software domain which,
yes,
which is, it's again a misnomer that everyone in India is from, every product manager in India is, you know, having the software expertise. It's just that, you know, people that you would have interacted with, it might seem as though that they have,
sure,
expertise. In fact, even personally, a lot of the software know-how, software knowledge, I picked up on the job. Because, you know, as you mentioned earlier, I was a design engineer at NVIDIA. I had a lot of hardware concepts. We were building physical products at NVIDIA. And the transition to becoming a software product manager, if I can even use that word, you know, through my experience at ZipDial, Zivame, and you know, my startup and at Intuit, has been a good learning. But then, even I don't fit into the traditional mold of having software engineering, being you know, building software products and transitioning to becoming a product manager, right? So one thing is, again, going back to, I'm again trying to fit how companies see it. So there's one way of saying that, hey, I have all these talents, I have, you know, all these skill sets, I think I'm the right profile for a product manager. That's one way of seeing it. The other way is looking at the, you know, looking across the pond, looking at the companies, telling that, hey, you are doing this, you need this, and this is how I can fit myself into that.
Got it.
Right? So I think that part is important. People are always, they don't want any, like if I'm a hiring manager, again, I don't want to use my cognitive load in order to see how you will fit.
Absolutely.
So if you can actually do that for me, that is where I'm going to be impressed and I'm going to say that, hey, welcome on board. Please start your product management journey with us, right? Or continue your product management journey. So that way, if you're a software engineer today, two traditional paths you would see. If you just look at the data around how people have become product manager. One is within the company, they show an inclination towards product management, inclination towards taking on new responsibilities, and they gravitate towards product management. Right? Lot of companies today, I would say that majority of the software or majority of the product companies based out of India have a product management function.
Sure.
Traditionally, they may not have had it, but today they see the need for it. So who best to look out for when they are looking to build out a product management organization than to look at their own employees? They already understand the culture, they understand what the company is going for, they understand many of the customer challenges. If they can actually show an inclination, if they show that they have the appetite, if they can prove it out, and some companies have this unstructured time, they have 20% time, 10% time to your pet projects, etc. If they can actually show that they are interested towards it, they don't need any formal education in that. If they go down that path, they can move towards product management. The other route that you see a lot of people take is getting a management degree.
Sure.
Right? You get a management degree there, you show that, hey, you have picked up courses in marketing, branding, pricing, etc., strategy, and then you showcase your skills to the companies and you say that, hey, this was my past experience, technical, non-technical, etc. This is what I've actually picked up during my management degree, and this is what I bring to the table, and this is how a lot of people get into product management.
Got it.
Right? So both the paths are there. There's no right or wrong path. Both are successful. And in fact, these are not just the two paths. We started off saying that, hey, how can anyone get into product management, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. But I would say that these are just two well-proven paths. You see a lot of people doing that. For the others, the onus is on you in order to prove that, hey, this is a successful way to transition into product management.
So then in summary, for people who are looking to get into product management, specifically people from the software domain, one of the easiest ways is to make an internal transition.
Yes.
Because the company knows you well, you know the company culture well, so you'll be able to fit in very well. And either you use some time that the company gives you, like a 10% time doing your pet projects, or maybe after your day job you start showing your own interest and your own enthusiasm, and that kind of impresses the team that's actually wanting a product manager, and then you can slowly transition. And for people who don't have that kind of an opportunity, then some kind of a professional degree, like an MBA, a management degree, or even certification courses like what our parent company Upgrad offers in the product management domain, could be really helpful to bridge that gap.
Definitely. Yes.
Perfect. Cool. Thanks a lot, Girish. Now we'll actually move to a question that Vikram asks, and this is we spoke some time was spent in talking about how to move to product management from an unrelated domain or from a software engineering domain. I want to now get into product management interviews, because that's another thing that you have to kind of overcome or you have to master to finally land the job. And I think that's a very interesting question from Vikram, and while that is in great detail, and credit to Vikram for kind of putting in that effort, but I'll just try to read that out and summarize it. As a program manager, I have a fair idea about product management, the ideology, the metrics, etc. However, during interviews, when somebody asks a specific product question around metrics, etc., then what happens is, it's difficult for him. He doesn't understand the approach to these kind of questions, right? While he covers high-level possible engagement metrics, but beyond a point, I think, there are cracks in his approach. And I think this is a very common question because many people want to understand that, you know, in a product management interview, if you have questions around, you know, product metrics, and which probably are posed at a very high superficial level, then how do you approach these questions and, you know, kind of drill down to the detail so that the interviewer basically is convinced that, you know, you have the right approach and you are actually, you know, giving or taking the right path to derive the exact insights. So could you basically, you know, kind of delve a bit on it? And these metric based questions could be anything around, you know, churn rates, on sales progressions, on customer lifetime values, on dropout percentages, etc.
Sure, great question, Vikram. Thanks for posting. One thing I would like to call out is, yes, while it is very important to be, you know, grounded in data, it's easy to get lost in a lot of these metrics. I'm being very open and frank with this question here. Yes, in a product management interview, it is more likely than not that you will be asked a lot of data related questions. But I've always believed that you need to take a step back. You need to look at why this metric is important for you to solve a particular problem to a customer. Can you actually answer it holistically, right? Be it churn rate, retention rate, etc. Can you actually say that, hey, I'm actually solving this particular pain point of the customer, which is why I'm able to retain more users. I'm solving this pain point, which is why I'm able to make sure that, you know, at the end of day one, my churn rate reduces, right? First time user onboarding, etc. Can you actually look at what a customer needs and what the inherent competitive advantage that the product, the company has, and bridge the two and bring in the metrics in that regard? Because you could have become a product manager from a business intelligence or a data analyst background. You could already have all the smarts around, hey, how do you use data, how do you build the data pipelines, etc. But it's not necessary that you know that. For a lot of people, they may or may not be very comfortable with math in general, but then you need to have a good grasp of data, being able to figure out the insights from data, being able to say whether, hey, feel your gut and say whether this is the right decision from my product perspective or not. So in that regard, look at the question. So when, you know, someone asks you, how do you improve the conversion rate, right? Instead of just going down and saying that, hey, okay, so this is a three-part funnel, right? There is X percentage drop in the first, Y percentage in the second, Z percentage in the third, and overall conversion rate is this, X, Y, into Z, right? Instead of just laying it out like that, can you bring in some more insights? Can you say that, hey, you know, I'm looking at this particular check, you know, funnel, it could be a checkout funnel. I'm looking at this particular checkout funnel and comparing it against, you know, standards in the industry. I'm comparing it against other checkout flows within the company, right? So, and then you say that there, you know, I think we could do well in this particular regard and improve conversion rate because, we are falling short at this point. And this is how I would go about doing it. You know, improve the content, improve some of the technical challenges in implementation, etc. Whatever be it, can you at least bring in that view? Can you actually bring in some more insights and say why that data point is important rather than just going down to the math?
Got it. So fundamentally what you're trying to say is, you know, in all these conversion kind of conversion metric kind of questions, not just look at it superficially and talk about, you know, at every stage what is the percentage conversion, how you can improve, but get some industry standard, get an added flavor, an extra dimension to that entire thinking process, because that's going to help you, you know, derive more insights and fundamentally help, you know, kind of improve the whole process rather than just looking at the data. Though being a data driven player is a given,
yes.
But you know, adding this dimension helps.
Yes.
Great. Vishal Kumar Singh, and guys, by the way, keep the questions coming. I mean, this is turning out to be a really engaging session. So we would like to cover as many questions as possible in this Q&A hour. So please keep your questions coming. Our intention here is to ensure that each one of you goes back, a more informed person around the product management domain. No question is a bad question. We are trying to prioritize all your questions. So I would really, really urge each one of you to not just be passive listeners, but please drop in your questions. I can see all these questions coming, and I will actually try my best to prioritize all of them during this Ask Me Anything hour. Coming back, Vishal Kumar Singh asks, if you haven't built something from scratch, does that really impact you as a product manager? If yes, how much of an impact is it? If no, then how can you actually cover it during interviews? Do people who build something from scratch, are they prioritized more than people who haven't built something from scratch? And more importantly, if you haven't built something from scratch in an interview, and if you ask some question around it, how do you actually, kind of face that question and answer that question in a convincing fashion?
Sure, great question again. So I would say they're different. So product management as a function has different needs, right? Depending on the company, you could be managing a mature product. You're in an established firm, it's got products which have been around for a while. There are users who have been using, thousands of users who have been using it. It's a mature product. You're not trying to rock the boat, so to say, but you're trying to see how you can nudge the customers from point A to point B. That's one type of product management. Other product management, you could join product management in a startup where you're still trying to figure out the product market fit. You want to rapidly iterate. You want to just build something, even if it's not polished, throw it out there, get feedback from customers, and then see. So both ends of the spectrum are there. Of course, there are many other types of product management, but just with respect to this question, I just thought, if just think about it that way. It's not that a company needs only one type of product manager, and nobody would have done all that, build all types of products upfront. So be truthful. If you are asked, have you built anything from scratch? If you have done it, great. Talk about your experience. If you have not, be truthful, say that you haven't. But then it's not that every hiring manager or every company is looking to only pick up people who have built a product from scratch. There are plenty of people who are great product managers who may not have done it. Why do you need to do it is again the question. Are you trying to bring a new product to the market which doesn't exist, right? Or are you trying to disrupt a particular industry? Then the reason behind asking this question is, can you rapidly iterate? Can you just roll out prototypes one after the other, look at data, look at feedback, then change the product vision, the product roadmap, and get a product out there which customers would love. So the idea is to check if you have the skills to go about on this journey. When they're asking you if you have built a product from scratch, if you have done it, great. If not, at least talk about how you would go about doing so. Talk about the fact that, hey, you follow any design principle, lean design, for instance. You will go about with a rapid iterative model, a small team, just throw things out. You'll not wait to just write out the specs, polish the specs, make sure that it's a great product before it ships, right? You will be scratching. So that's what they are looking for. And it's okay if you haven't done anything from scratch. It is not something that's going to hold you back. Everyone gets a chance at one time or the other, given that if there is a need, and you could always show your skills there.
Great. I'll then move to a slightly different question here, and I think this will this will result in you putting on your entrepreneurial hat, apart from already putting on your product management hat. So, Venkat asks, a lot of us have wonderful product or business ideas, but only a few of us are able to launch it into successful businesses. Even though there is a no one size fits all kind of a formula, it would be really helpful to know if you can give a structured approach on how to convert an idea into full-fledged software product.
Great question. As a product manager, what I've always believed is that end of the day, product manager is responsible to ship. ship a product, ship a code, bring things to the market. That's the primary responsibility of the product manager.
Sure.
We don't talk about the fact that, hey, there are multiple aspects within a product lifecycle. You know, research, design, idea is of course one of them, but the crux is to actually execute and ship. That is a very, very valuable skill. So when you are asking about how do you bring the idea to the market, it's a great question, because a lot of people will have ideas, but the execution is what comes. Execution is the tough part, right? It's just a myth that product managers are the ones who come up with ideas. It's not, right? Product managers are the ones who help, you know, bring the idea to life. Now, the question of can you come up with a structured approach in order to bring this, you know, a great idea to life, that again goes back to what are you trying to solve for? Is it, you know, similar to how we looked at the comparison between being a product manager for a mature product versus being a product manager for a startup and you're trying to bring a new product to life? So if you have an idea, and if you need to actually bring it out, if you want to execute it, the question would again come back to, is it something that, is it a feature that is going to be added to an existing product? Is it an idea that's going to come out with, is it a standalone product that you're trying to launch? Irrespective, you would want to just go back to some of the fundamentals. What is the value that this is your idea, which is going to translate into a product, is going to give to customers? How do you actually figure out if there is an appetite from customers for this particular value, right? How do you rapidly iterate in order to say that, hey, okay, this is what I'm going to push out there. I'm going to get feedback, or I'm going to just figure out that, when I say feedback, it could just be a mock on a sheet of paper that you could just pass around and ask people what do they think about it. You don't have to actually do invest more than that. Run dry tests. If you have additional resources at your disposal, then go about build prototypes and get further validation for your idea. But it's important to proceed ahead from the project. A lot of people have this, have an inertia to just get started. Easiest way is to just, you know, talk to people about it, ask people, draw something out, build some rudimentary prototype. Again, you know, building prototypes depends on the kind of idea you have, but it is very important for you to validate your idea and go down along the path of execution, and slowly you will realize that the momentum is building. You of course have the passion. You will realize that, hey, you're channeling your passion and your energy and getting this momentum and bringing your idea to life. But it is important to go down that path. There are plenty of ways in which you could go down, but to get started off, to actually bring it out, get feedback on it, is very important. So forget the inertia, start off on it, is what I would say.
Great. So in summary, what you're trying to say is, you know, kind of take the plunge. Execution is 100 times more important than just an idea. Ideas are a dime a dozen. And more importantly, you really don't have to invest heavily on day one. You can actually run lean experiments by piggybacking on existing platforms and try to gauge user feedback. That will give you more confidence around the length and breadth of your idea. And once you have that kind, you develop that kind of confidence by running these lean experiments, you can then actually, you know, kind of start thinking on how to build a full-fledged product from a kind of a MVP, as it's called, a minimum viable product offering. Great. Thanks a lot, Girish. Next question is around, you know, a B2B product manager versus B2C product manager. And we see this, you know, kind of a discussion happening a lot of times where, you know, people say that the skills required for B2B product management is slightly different from those required for B2C product management, or vice versa. B2B product managers generally, you know, are in a different domain. B2C product managers are in a different domain. So I thought I should actually, you know, kind of bring this up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you've been a founder, you've worked as a B2B product manager, you've worked as a B2C product manager at different times in your career. And, you know, this is something that's asked by Angad. So what aspects do you find are the most interesting in each of these roles? And how do you think these can align with any person's long-term goals? So what are the great things you saw in, you know, as a B2B product manager, some of the great things you see as a B2C product manager, some of the great things you see as a software, you know, product entrepreneur, and how that ties up into a long-term goal for any individual.
Great question, I should say. I do believe that you need to wear different hats from a skill set perspective when you're a B2B product manager or a B2C product manager. So let me start with just some fundamental differences in my opinion between a B2B and a B2C product manager. So as a B2C product manager, it is important for you to have a sense of data, to be more data driven. Not that the importance is any less for a B2B, but let me just tell you that for a B2C product manager, you need to not just think about what your customers are asking today, but what your customers are not asking today, and what the feel like, where you feel the product is going to evolve into, and how you actually get this out. A lot of examples of B2C product managers, you typically have a number of, you have thousands, millions of customers for a B2C product. If you're good on with your data analytics skills, you can actually leverage that in order to get the feedback back from customers to see how you can improve it and get your product or evolve your product into ways that the customers haven't thought possible or haven't felt a need for yet, right? So I would say that it is very important for a B2C product manager to be extremely data-driven from a decision-making perspective. Having said that, if you look at a B2B product manager, now your customers are the other businesses that use your product. So it's not like you don't have customers, but typically you have a smaller subset from a customer base as compared to your product usage as a B2C product manager. So for a B2B product manager, where are you spending a lot of your time? You're spending a lot of time prioritizing your product features vis-a-vis the requirements of your major customers. So in this case, you have a handful of big customers who are major users of your product, who are major revenue drivers for your company, and they'll have their own wish list of what they would like to see in your product. New features, enhancements to existing features, bug fixes, etc. So and you have your long-term vision of your product, right? So how do you prioritize the needs and requirements coming from your primary, like your major customers, against your long-term vision of your product? So that is a skill that you'll have to actively use, along with making sure that as a B2B product manager, you'll have to be really good with respect to making sure that even the first version of the product that goes out to your customer is well-specced, well-tested. You do your internal dogfooding. All of that you need to be really good at, right? Make sure that it's well project managed. For a B2C product, it could be a scrappy product that you get feedback from. But for a B2B product, you need to make sure that even the first version of the product, it could be an internal MVP, but that still needs to be specced out. Your success metrics need to be laid out, well tested, because you, end of the day, you're dealing with another customer, another business, which is using that product to service its customers, right? So think of it from their angle. They still need something that they can take it to their customers. So it needs to be polished. You need to do a lot more work from a spec perspective, from just some of the hard skills perspective, and make sure that the first version of the product that goes out to your B2B customer is still something that you learn from, but at the same time, a polished version of your end product.
And you spoke about B2C product managers versus B2B product managers. What about, you know, being an entrepreneur who's launching software products? Because you've done everything.
So as an entrepreneur, it's not just a product manager, right? As an entrepreneur, the buck stops with you. You can't say it's not your job. whether it is legal, accounting, finance, etc., everything stops with you. So if you're trying to get a product out there, you have to think of everything from branding. You have to think of everything from software license, like, you know, the software code. Where are you housing your code, your servers, your infrastructure, your team? And of course, you have to think about your product and your business.
Got it.
Right? So it's just that it's you still need all the know-how, the skills that of a product manager. But along with it, since the buck stops with you, since you can't say that it's not my responsibility, you need a more holistic view. I know that there is a common saying that, you know, product managers are the CEOs of their product. I don't believe that. That's because if you are the CEO of a company, you have direct responsibility, you have people directly reporting to you, you have the authority to influence. But if you are a product manager, you know, outside of being an entrepreneur, you have to influence without authority, right? You typically don't have, you might have other product managers reporting to you, but your core team and your extended team are all people who don't directly report to you, whom you have to influence. So that's a key difference.
Very important. Very, very important point. Like, I have been a product manager, I have been a CEO of a company, and I think this is a very interesting observation. I have probably done this, but I've never really, you know, been conscious that this is a big difference. I have been a product manager at Intuit myself, and I realized that, you know, I really didn't have people reporting into me. I mean, product managers are individual contributors for most, most phases of that product management stint. And that, you know, to get work out from other people who are not necessarily reporting to you requires a lot of, you know, I would say wonderful persuasion skills, wonderful skill to influence. But as a CEO, you know, because at some level everything goes up to you, there is an element of authority that you can exercise. Though having said that, as a CEO, there are a plethora of other responsibilities that, you know, you have to look into apart from kind of the core responsibility of growing your product. But as a product manager, it's the product and it is possibly your baby, and you just have to look into it, the finance, the legal, the procurement, and the other allied responsibilities around the administration, around the product itself is something that you cannot, I mean, you need not care about. Great answer, Girish. So fundamentally then, as a B2C product manager, you have to be completely data driven, you have to be completely driven by insights. As a B2B product manager, you are solving for those 10, 15 or whatever smaller number of big customers who are giving you the largest chunk of revenue. Think about their needs. And as a B2B product manager, basically, you know, you can't just build a scrappy product and release it into the market, because you are fundamentally releasing to a business which in all probability is using it to release to their end customers. So you have to be more careful and more, I would say, more structured in doing your product releases and in, you know, kind of interacting with your customers. Great. I think this is a wonderful you know, answer from Girish. Again, I exhort each one of you to please pour in your questions here. Girish has taken time out and given his vast knowledge of experience in the B2B domain, in the B2C domain, also as an entrepreneur. I think he is best suited to answer all your questions. So as I reiterate, no question is a bad question. Keep them coming. Our next question comes from Shubham Agarwal. And he says, is it important to only find product management roles in your own industry, or should people look for different industries when they are looking for a new role or when they are looking for a transition? Do companies prefer different industry perspectives when they are looking to, you know, fill positions in their product teams?
Sure. You know, in all truthfulness, this is something I've actually learned from Srini. So when you're looking to get into a product manager position, if you just look at it from a variable perspective, right? There are two variables here. One is, you know, you might be looking to switch a company, but when I say switch a company, it's like go from, you know, company A to company B within the same industry, but you're not, say, switching your domain. Or you could be looking to switch your domain as well, which is what Shubham is also alluding towards, going to a different industry where you are then saying that, hey, maybe you're a product manager in company A, you're now switching to a product manager in company B in a completely different domain. But you can always talk about how the product management skills that you have and that you have demonstrated in company A are relevant to company B. So this, I would say that, yes, this is very much possible. Or you could say that you're within the same industry. You have a different function. Say you're a designer, or you're a software engineer, or you're a content writer, or you're a quality analyst, etc. within the same industry, and you would like to switch your function to becoming a product manager. Right? But you're within the same company, within the same industry. You already have that industry know-how, and you can do it. You can always demonstrate that, hey, you have the know-how of the industry, the challenges, the customers, etc. And therefore, and you're showing the requisite appetite to become, be a product manager and the skills, and therefore you can gun to be a product manager. Where it gets challenging is where you need to switch both your function and your industry. You're a software engineer, for instance, in company A, which is in industry A, and you want to switch to a product manager in company B, which is in an industry B. That's where it's sort of like a leap of faith for the company which is trying to hire you, right? That's where you need to demonstrate your soft skills and your hard skills to a greater extent. Why should they hire you as compared to people who are closer to their industry, or who are closer to the product management function, who have probably already been doing product management or already in that industry? So the onus will again come back to you. Can you demonstrate that you have the relevant skills, relevant experience in order to do well at your role?
Great. So fundamentally, you're trying to say that there are two parameters. One is the industry and one is your role. Yeah. And if you're trying to switch between industries and between roles, then it gets slightly challenging, and that's where you have to put a very strong case about yourself. But within the same industry, moving roles is easy, or within the same role, moving industries is easy. Yes. And more so for a role like product management, which is like a general management role in a software company, where the fundamental tenets of how something great. I wanted to now take a different question up, and this also, kind of delves into a very different facet of product management, which is stakeholder management. Mm-hmm. Anmol Rastogi asks, the biggest challenge in the product management domain today is to handle effective communication within multiple stakeholders. Most of the time, it is very difficult to get the right contact of the right stakeholder. Mm-hmm. How should someone come up with this challenge? I think he effectively means, how should someone overcome this challenge effectively? Girish, your thoughts. You work for a startup, you work for a mid-sized company, you're now working for a big billion-dollar company based out of San Francisco. So, how do you do effective stakeholder management? And I think that also is an important aspect of product management at large. So, your thoughts here.
Sure. Anmol, I'm just guessing here, but I think that, you've already faced the challenges around, stakeholder management, around communication in your current role as a product manager. I completely empathize with you. I agree. Look, even in my current role, if I have to just think about, so we spoke about all the skills that a product manager needs at the role, right? So if I can call that as a hard skill, and your stakeholder management and communication as the soft skills, if I think about my role as a product manager today, and if I have to put a number to how much time I spent on soft skills versus how much time I spent on hard skills, I would say it's actually an 80-20. 80% of the time goes in evangelizing the product, in stakeholder management, in communicating the vision of the product, in aligning the teams together in order to buy into the vision before we actually go down into some of the hard skills around, hey, Is the backlog in place? Are you prioritizing the right things? Are you writing the stories? Are you following up with your core teams, this one, design, engineering, etc., in order to roll the product out? Are you tracking the right metrics? Are you doing the release management, etc.? So those hard skills today probably take 20% of my time. 80% of my time actually goes in stakeholder management. And that is a key aspect of being a product manager. It is underemphasized to a large extent, if I have to say that, because communicating is the primary function of a product manager. But communicating for the right reasons, right? Communicating, bringing people together. It's not that, it's a myth that all a product manager does is set up meetings and bring people together. It's like you are being the conduit between various teams. So therefore you're bringing people together. Therefore you're setting up the meetings. And therefore you're figuring out who the stakeholders are. And to answer your question specifically, Anmol, on how do you find the right contact? There's no one answer to that. You need to make your voice heard, because at the end of the day, you're representing a lot of other teams. Like for instance, I would say that when you are a product manager in a meeting, you're representing everyone who is not in the meeting. Right? You could be having a meeting with, say, design and engineering. Now you are representing everyone who is a stakeholder who is not in design and engineering. The onus is on you. Whether it is content, whether it is legal, whether it is marketing, etc. You are now wearing those hats. Now, when you're talking to marketing, you need to say that, hey, you need to talk about how engineering might play a role in any decision that you take. So that way, when you're communicating with all these other teams, you need to build your contact base within your company. And of course, you know, when you get into a new role, new job, there are always your colleagues, your manager, and your other stakeholders who are willing to help you. But that effort needs to be put in by you. You need to go about saying that, hey, I understand that this is the product, these are the various downstream stakeholders who could be impacted by any change that you're doing. You need to make sure that you're reaching out to them ahead of time, appraising them about the change, why the change is coming about, how it's going to solve for the end consumer, and make sure that you're bringing everyone on board. And that, whether you like it or not, is going to take majority of your time.
Got it. Great. Raghavendra Manjunath asks, what are the key things to start off when looking to move from a non-tech program manager role to a product manager role? I think that's something that Girish covered at breadth at the start of the session. So Raghavendra, you can have a look at the recorded video after the session. The first part of the video covers this in detail. I'll move to the next question, which is asked by Vishal again asks, does frequent career breaks make an impact on product management career? If the reason is genuine, say if someone is working on building a new product since a few months and suddenly the product is stopped due to some reasons that upper management didn't want to take it forward, will that impact one's resume or one's product management career in the future?
Great question again, Vishal. It will definitely be asked. Now, just laying out the question again, frequent changes, anyone is going to ask you why you kept switching. Because any product, the product life cycle, we know the product life cycle, right? You research, you design, you work with your team in order to execute, then you launch, and then you do the whole thing again. If you get the data back, you iterate over it. Now, the question would always be that, hey, if you have kept switching, how have you been able to improve upon a product that you have launched? How have you actually learned from any mistakes that you would have done while building the product? So that is going to be the thing that that's going to come up. But then, can you justify the reason for the change? So as you actually put it, that the project was stopped for some reason. So is it that you have worked on different projects within your current job role, or is it that you have actually switched job roles, and therefore you need to, and therefore you are worried that it's going to impact your resume. I have actually come across both cases wherein within a company I've seen that someone within a 7 year span they had switched 7 different roles within the company and they were just trying out many things. They still were a great fit for the role that you know we were hiring for and we did take them. So it depends on how you are able to justify each of the switches that you made. Was it that you were forced to do it because of business reasons, because of market conditions, or was it that something didn't work out within the team and that you decided to move on? There could be n number of reasons, but can you justify the reasons and can you then say that irrespective of that, this is what was this is what I learned from this experience and this learning is what I carry with me. It didn't matter that I only spent 4 months. Like you could be an entrepreneur for just 4 months, but you could have learned a lot during that time. You could work in a product management role in a company for 4 years and just learn the same amount. So can you bring out your learnings and can you justify each of the switches is what I would call out.
Yeah, great point. And here I would also like to add from my personal experience. So I have been building products, or been part of teams that have been building products for close to past 10 years. And I can tell you that Cohort Plus was the fourth product that I was, part of building, right? I was an entrepreneur. Two products that I built when I started my career were, I was not exactly the CEO, I was not exactly the founder, but both those products shut down, the first two products, right? The second product, it was really painful because it had millions of users and for various regulatory issues and the fact that we were not able to monetize at the right time, we had to finally take a call on shutting it down, right? In this entire journey, right, and I have actually interacted with recruiters, I've interacted with hiring managers, they did ask me why the product shut down, but I think that was only like 10% of the entire discussion. The remaining 90% of discussion was completely centered around, what I learned while I was building the product. And, that is what was given more value while they were evaluating my candidature and not the fact that the final outcome of the product, unfortunately, was that the product had to shut down. That's one part of the answer. The second part of the answer here is, did you yourself learn, as Girish rightly pointed out, and grow as an individual? I think that is very important, right? This is the, as I said, Cohort Plus is the fourth product, past three products have shut down. But what I learned from each of those product experiences actually helped me enhance the subsequent product that I was working on, right? And all those learning experiences actually culminated in some way in the future. So always remember that, there would be reasons why some products might shut down and those reasons might be beyond you, as you pointed out, Vishal. But in the future, there would be a way in which all these dots would get connected. So fundamentally, if I were in your position, well, I would actually keep an eye out on what the future of the product is. But what I would really be interested in this whole scheme of things is to realize or to understand what I learn by contributing to the product, right? My personal learning, my individual learning, my individual growth as a product person is super important. If that happens, then God forbid, even if your product shuts down, I'm sure the recruiters as well as the hiring managers will still see you in very favorable light.
Very well put, yeah.
I now go to, this question by, basically, I think B2B versus B2C has been covered. So I think this one by Samba Sivarao. Yeah, I think Samba Sivarao asks, what are the basic skills required for a product manager? More importantly, how do I self-assess whether I can shift my career towards product management or not?
Great, okay. We started off this session by saying, what does it take to be a product manager, right? You need the passion, you need the intellect, you need the customer empathy, right? Can you be the voice of the customer? But most importantly, do you have the energy in order to run with this job? Because as a product manager, you're constantly you're constantly bringing people together, constantly ideating, constantly following up with people. And all of this, as Shini also mentioned earlier, you are trying to influence without authority. Thus, as I would say, Samba Shivura, think about, if you want to be a product manager, just think about all the things that you are going to give up on, right? It's a thankless job. Since the buck stops at you, if it goes well, great. The team executed really well, everything works well, you know, everyone's happy. If something doesn't go well, your neck is on the line. So that's one. Second one is, you have to be, like, every aspect of the product, you're responsible for it. If there is some work that is not getting done, it could be, your line of work, or it need not be your line of work, but again, the responsibility ends with you. Legal, marketing, engineering, etc. Any piece of work that needs to be done for the product, you're still responsible for it, right? So, couple this with it being a thankless job, you need to really think about the fact that, hey, is it something that you want to get into, considering that, one and two put together, it is going to be a high-stress job. Do you want to do it? And do you have what it takes in order to bring that product to life, execute it, plow through it, overcome all the challenges that are there, never give up, and continue to work on the product till it gets into the hands of the customer, and do it all over again.
Great. Unfortunately, we are short on time. So I will actually have to, end this session here. First of all, a big, big thank you to Girish for taking time out. I have been chasing him for some time, as I mentioned at the beginning of the session. So it finally, fell in place. I think this has been a super useful session. Some really good insights, which we were able to, extract from Girish's rich experience of having built products in the past 5-6 years in the B2B domain, in the B2C domain, and also, touching into the entrepreneurial side of things and how, entrepreneurs who are building software products can manage things at that end. So this has been a really useful session. This session is going to get recorded, so we will share the link of the recording with each one of you. But there is one last thing that I want to leave each of you with. Two points. One is, if at all you've joined this session and were referred by a friend, or got to know about it through some other external source, I want to talk to you a bit about Cohort Plus, the platform. It is the largest community for product management professionals. People come here, they interact with like-minded product managers, they ask doubts, their queries get resolved, they get to know what is happening in the product management world, they keep themselves updated and abreast with the latest happenings in the product management domain. There's a lot of useful content that not just we generate as the admins of the community, but it's also generated from our users. Check our blogs out. So this entire forum, this entire community is free. So I would exhort each one of you to actually join it if you haven't, and get useful insights and help fashion our careers. This event that we are doing is part of a larger objective. We've recently we've been bought by the learning education company UpGrad, and both us as a community and UpGrad as a career provider, we believe in the common vision of building careers of tomorrow. Today we spoke about how you can fashion your product management career. We really want to partner with you in your career and help take your career to the next level. So while there is the Cohort Plus community that you can actually be part of, get engaged, see what is happening in the product management world, learn about product management as a discipline through your peers, as well as people who are more experienced than you through mentorship sessions, etc. What you can also do is basically kind of take the certification courses that is provided by a company or brand, in specifically in the product management domain. There are very, very, very few, you know, companies that are providing you specialization in product management, and Upgrad does that, and that is in collaboration with Duke CE, a premium brand in the product management domain. So do check that out if you're interested in the course. The course actually helps you, it provides you a structure with regards to, you know, preparing for your product management career, or to launch your product management career. And by structure, I actually mean some of these questions that Girish delved upon, you get to know in more detail, like, you know, what is it like to become a B2B product manager? What is it like to become a B2C product manager? What are the differences? What are the different metrics that a B2B product manager chases versus a B2C product manager chases? Or, you know, even if you are actually thinking whether product management is a career for you or not, you can go to upgrad.com and you can check out whether product management as a domain is something that excites you. More importantly, for a lot of people who are actually, you know, not in the product management domain but want to actually make a transition, as Girish rightly mentioned, if you can do an internal transition, that's great. That's actually, you know, commendable and highly suggested. But you can also check out the Upgrad courses. That's one wonderful way for you to actually make a good transition and make your foray into the product management domain. So a lot of, you know, what we discussed here is something that is provided in the course itself in a structured fashion. So do check that out also, and do check our community out. It's completely free to join, and I'm sure you will actually gain a ton of insights by being a part of the product management community there, and it will help you, you know, kind of take the next big step in your career. For any other remnant questions that we couldn't answer, I'm always available. My email ID is srinivasan@coartplus.com, srinivasan@coartplus.com. You can actually drop in your questions there. I'll be happy to answer each one of your questions, and me and my team at Upgrad would be really happy to, you know, kind of support you and help you take the next big step in your career. Thanks one and all.
Thank you all.
Thanks, Girish.
Thanks, Jimmy.